Good morning. I have a great talk here for everybody. If I can just put into words the clarity that is here. One of the most astonishing statements, many astonishing statements I can make, but we must keep in mind that when Jesus left this world, he said, I'm sending you your teacher. The Holy Spirit is your teacher. Jesus didn't say he was our teacher. He said the Holy Spirit's our teacher. So the fact is that Christianity is not supposed to be about Jesus. It's supposed to be about the Holy Spirit. That's a fact. And I am a Holy Spirit Christian. I'm not a Jesus Christian. I'm a Holy Spirit Christian. I'm not a Mary Christian. Holy Spirit Christian. Different. Big difference. Holy Spirit is with us, within us, directly clarifying for us, guiding us every instant of the day, showing us what's going on, putting it in perspective. Holy Spirit's done a great job in my instance because I put the Holy Spirit first. I said, I don't care about this or this or this or this or this. Let me listen to the voice of reason that is within. The Holy Spirit is the voice of reason that makes all things clear for us. Now, even A Course in Miracles, which is by Jesus explaining some things for us, a lot of stuff for us. Even that, I listened to the Holy Spirit explain it to me, what's said. So, my understanding of A Course in Miracles, it comes from the Holy Spirit. It doesn't come from Jesus. And it's a little different than what's out there in the marketplace. You know, I look up to the marketplace, I say, that's not what the Holy Spirit is telling me. That's not it at all. That's coming from an emotional standpoint. A flesh standpoint, a lot of what I see out there, it just doesn't jive with what I'm seeing. What the Holy Spirit has told me is relocation to the death-free realm is the answer. Again, the Holy Spirit can manifest a world instantly. How? Through definition. The Holy Spirit is a special creation of the Prime Creator, specifically designed to help spirit out of this continuity issue that it has, to dropping definition, to finally drop definition. Because what we are is what God created us as, and that is eternal life. All life extends endlessly. What dies was never alive in the first place. All life extends endlessly. There's no death in life whatsoever. There's no definition because it extends endlessly. Okay. You can't say it's defined. Yes, you can have experiences, but it's not the way we're used to thinking of life here. What is this world is nothing but definitions of death. It's an attempt to define death. That's all that this world is. This world is truly an abomination. You might say a abomination, as it were. It truly is an abomination, this world. It is the attempt to define death. That's all that it is. So the Holy Spirit is a creation of the Prime Creator that wasn't there in the beginning, but was a supplement to creation to bless the definitions that spirit has made of death, because spirit is trying to bring about its own death so that it can be Prime Creator. It is trying to change what it is. It's trying to say, I want out of reality. I'm going to make my own new reality. And so it's trying to put boundaries on endless eternal life and bring about its own death in so doing. And this existence is just a simulation of time, a simulation of boundaries, a training ground, a classroom where spirit is trying to learn how to die. And so into this classroom, into this training exercise, the Holy Spirit reaches out to us and says, hey, I can bless all definitions that you have made. I can do that. God gave me created me with the capacity to do that. And we say, huh? Like, what? Because when we fell asleep, when we went into the simulation, of definition, simulation of time, there wasn't any Holy Spirit. So we're ignorant of the fact that that God created a special creation to bless all definitions and therefore to enable us to get over this continuity issue. We're habituated to definitions, trying to define what we are. And so we're afraid to drop this all definitions like that. We're afraid to do it like that. So the Holy Spirit says, no problem. I'll bless all definitions. And then you can train to go. I'll give you a training program to go beyond all definitions. The blessing of definitions is a new training program to help us drop trying our definitions of life, trying to define life boundaries. There's the end point. Okay, this is where life ends. Life doesn't end. There's no such thing as an ending to life. So the Holy Spirit has an entire training program to enable us to drop all definitions. And this is the good news. The good news is not that Jesus was crucified on the cross and all this kind of, that's not the good news. The good news is that there's a Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is with us. That's the good news. And so the good news is that God made a special supplement to creation to give us a training program to deal with this continuity issue around definitions. That is the good news. That is it. That is the good news. Again, it's not Jesus that's the good news. It's the Holy Spirit that's the good news. And this is something those who are still trying to define what they are, who are stuck in definition, insist on the good news being a person, a body, a definition. They insist upon saying, no, that is the good news, that we were able to kill truth. That spirit died. They say, no, the good news is that we found a way to kill spirit, and now we can live in a new creation. And they say, that's the good news. That's not the good news. If that were true, that would be total annihilation of reality and no resurrection at all. So that's not the good news. The good news is the Holy Spirit. That's the good news. So this is something that I know the emotional, those who are still caught up in the emotionalism of the flesh, and of which is definition, the attempt to define life, which is really attempt to define death. Remember that. This is, Jesus said, this is the kingdom of death. Now, Jesus said a lot of great, great things, but the good news is the Holy Spirit. He came to say, look, this is what you're trying to do. Okay, Jesus' whole passion play was to show us what we are trying to do, which is to kill life. And then out of that death of life, we believe there'll be a resurrection, a new life, and that we'll have a new creation, we'll be prime creator. So Jesus allowed this passion play to take place to show us this is what you're trying to do. And then he said, okay, folks, now you know what you're trying to do, which is bogus. But here's the good news. God has created a special creation, the Holy Spirit, to give you a training program to drop this whole scenario, to drop this attempt to kill spirits and believe that, and then believe in a magical resurrection of spirit as a new creation, and that now spirit is created itself, and it can have a new, it'll be prime creator. Holy Spirit has a training program for you to drop this, and that is the good news. Because that he said, I'm leaving here now, you know, and I'm leaving the Holy Spirit with you. That's the good news. That is what really happened. The old passion play, the crucifixion, the resurrection, that was showing us spirit, what spirit is attempting to do, believing that there's this God, angry God, must sacrifice and wants the death of his son, and then after the death of his son, he'll resurrect the son and be in new life and all this stuff. That is what spirit is attempting to do. And that was pointed out to us very clearly. And then we say, but the Holy Spirit has come to bless the all definition, has a training program to free us from this. So that is the true gospel being delivered here, thanks to the Holy Spirit. And if one listens to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit will clarify this entire situation. Entire situation will clarify it for you. Now, there is going to be trouble in the world. There is no question that a war is coming. Last night, I had a dream, and I was interacting with all these military personnel in high positions of intelligence, etc., in the dream. And they let it be known to me that there is a big strike coming. There is a big war coming. They know about it. this world here is going to be engulfed in the attempt to define death. That's its purpose. So of course it's going to be about its purpose. But that is not the Father's purpose. The Father's purpose is to be about the Holy Spirit's training program. So real Christians will be about the Holy Spirit's training program. And that's a training program. It's not an emotionalism like so much of what's in the world now that passes for Christianity, etc., is emotionalism. And that sentimentalism. All this talk about love, oh, we need to love. That's sentimentalism. That's the flesh saying, oh, we need to love the flesh more. Okay. That's still defining death, saying we need to love death more. That is really what they're saying. It is literally what they are saying. That's not the Holy Spirit's training program. The Holy Spirit's training program is based on reason. It's based on clarity, the clarity of the Holy Spirit's reason, not the intellect, which is, comes from emotion, comes from emotionalism, comes from sentimentality, emotionalism. It gives rise to what's called the intellect. And the intellect is supposed to be the guide instead of the Holy Spirit telling us what we need to do. And the intellect will tell us, well, we need to spread tolerance everywhere. We need to learn to love everyone. That's the intellect coming from emotion, which comes from the attempt to define death. That is not the Holy Spirit's teaching. The Holy Spirit's teaching is based on clarity, insight, clarity of what's called reason, the voice of reason, that can see things and just calmly see. Say, oh, okay, I see this, I see this, I see this. That's love. Love is to inform others about the Holy Spirit's training program, to get free of definitions altogether. It's proper information. That's what love really is. Proper information, proper clarity, pointing out the good news of the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is the only one that knows how to administer this training program. It's the only one that knows. It's a special creation of God. Designed specifically to solve this problem that we have, Spirit has, of being habituated to definitions. And in this habituation with definitions arises all sorts of pseudo-remedies that the intellect gives, thinking that we can make it work. We can make it work. We cannot make it work. This world is a disaster. The church age is over. The church age was a bridge, okay? A Holy Spirit bridge across this infinite abyss of trying to define death. Once we've crossed that bridge, we don't need the bridge anymore. And the church age was a temporary situation of informing us about the Holy Spirit. That's the purpose of a church age, always. The purpose of religion is to inform us about the Holy Spirit. And in each planet, a place, a nexus of definitions of death, which is what the planet is, there is a time where temporarily we can make a big push to trust in the Holy Spirit. But the door closes. The opportunity closes. It doesn't stay open permanently, because definitions of death, eventually they regroup and they come storming in and try to engulf the whole planet in flames, which is what they will do. So it's important now to make the transition to a Holy Spirit world. Make the relocation to Holy Spirit world, leave this world behind. Shake the dust of this world off your feet, because again, this world is just a definition of death, and you certainly don't want that. And our time here has merely been an effort to reorient to Holy Spirit worlds, and so the time has come to complete that reorientation process. There's nothing really, you know, don't be sentimental about this world, that's for sure. Of course there are tinges of beauty in this world. And I just spent all day yesterday with this video camera taking incredibly beautiful videos using the zoom and blur and light intensity to give these wonderful play of light, etc. That you wouldn't see with your eyes. So you can get tinges that remind you like a faint echoes. You can get faint echoes of your home. But the Holy Spirit worlds are way, way, way better than that. They literally enable you to drop your definitions so you begin to feel in it, the extension, the infinite extension. You see, that is the thing. So it's way superior. So certainly it's time to trade up, to trade up. There's nothing wrong with that. You know, trade in the old clunker for a brand new, beautiful automobile. And of course we have sentimental attachment to a clunker. I used to have this old Mercedes, had like almost 280,000 miles on it, and it was just completely falling apart. I rarely could even drive it because it was constantly in the shop. It was just a nightmare. When I did get it to drive, it drove beautifully, but I couldn't trust to drive it anywhere because it would guaranteed it was going to break down. Something would go wrong, guaranteed. So it was a nightmare, horrible. But and when I had to finally part with that car, it just tore my heart out because it was so solid and beautiful. And my God, I said, if only this car could drive. If only it was new. But it wasn't. It was worn out. And I had a real tough time parting with that car. Seeing it towed away and I got nothing, I just felt like I was just about dead. I was distraught. This world is like that old Mercedes. It is worn out. It is absolutely worn out. And it's time for the junkyard. It is time for the junkyard. And what happens in the junkyard? It's parted out, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The recycled and all this stuff. And the world, this planet, will be remodeled and have a different. It will host definitions of death again, but it'll go on in a different format. But where it is right now, it's worn out. We have worked so hard to define death for this world, to find death, you know, that it's worn out. So it's time to turn it over to the junkyard. That's not an easy thing to do. And yesterday, all that beautiful video I took, I looked at it, and I looked at it and I said, well, it's okay, but, it's not worth dying for. This world is not dying for. No definitions are worth dying for. And that's the ultimate wisdom. The ultimate lesson of the Holy Spirit is nothing is worth dying for. That's the ultimate lesson. Definitions are not worth dying for. In the Holy Spirit's world, nothing dies. Nothing dies. There's no death at all in the Holy Spirit's world. Again, the Holy Spirit can manifest the world instantly. It simply defines it. In the Holy Spirit's mind, its blessing has a definition. Where there's no death at all, a form. It's a definition of life. And so that it can express that definition instantly, which can take the form of a realm, an entire realm. It may not even be a planet, it's a realm, where there's no boundaries. It's not like there's some planet in space that is bounded by space. We look out there and we get this feeling of being defined, right? Space, what does space do? It defines, doesn't it? But in the Holy Spirit's realm of definition, it doesn't have to be a globe being defined by space. It can be a realm where it stretches on, indefinitely. And you get this feeling, wow, this is just all this life that's not dying at all just stretches on forever. It's not bounded. We're not a little blue marble that the definitionists love the earth, because it's so defined. It's this little blue marble out of the inky darkness of space, and it's this tiny, 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 tiny definition, which is what we're trying to do. I mean, why is the universe so big? Because we're trying to make ourselves so small. That's why. We're trying to define death, which is to make ourselves tiny, tiny, smaller and smaller until we just disappear or nothing, dead. So, of course, how do we get this at this vast universe, and then here we are in this little tiny blue marble, in this little tiny body, we're trying to define ourselves as smaller and smaller, smaller and smaller and smaller, and tiny, 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 tiny. Okay? So, of course, those who are trying to define death love the world. one of the sayings of Jesus was that if anybody loves the world, God is not teen. You can check it up online. 1 John, 1 letter of John 2:15-17. Read that. Profound, profound quote. Very true. So in the Holy Spirit's realm, it doesn't end. You just realize, it goes on. I can see it. We're not in this little tiny marble out in space, as it were. That's the fifth dimension. The fifth dimension is tremendous, wonderful. No death there. And again, it's still a training exercise, of course. It's a training exercise. So you don't need to be all like, whoa, this is heaven or something. No, it's a training exercise. It's not the goal. So it takes all the awe out of it, you know, and you just enjoy it. If you were to arrive in the death-free realms, as I did in spirit already, if you think, oh, this is reality, this is heaven, I mean, now in reality, then you're going to think, oh my God, how do I function, you know, and you start getting nervous. So you have to see the truth of it. It is not heaven. It is not reality. It's what you might call paradise, the death-free realms. It's a training exercise. You're here for a training exercise. So you say, okay, great. And happy to be here. Happy to be here. Eager to get going on this training exercise. And I can feel it already. I can feel this place is really, I love the feeling of it. I'm really going to love this training exercise. That is the response. And so you're calm. You're calm. You say, no, this is an intermediate step. This isn't, I'm still quite a ways away from accepting reality as it is, because I'm still dealing with definitions. But that's fine. This is where I'm at. This is where I expect it to be. I'm ready now for the intermediate step. I'm ready for the Holy Spirit's training program. But, you know, that training program will go on until it's successful. And that's a ways off, so there's no pressure on me. There's no expectations that I'm freaking out about. No, I just say, okay, I made it. It's like you graduate from high school and now you first day of college. I say, okay, I know I can do it. I know I'll be successful, and it's gonna take some getting used to, and some training is training. So it's like that. And that takes the emotionalism out of it. It takes the fear, it takes all the stuff out of it. Yeah. So I'm trying to get rid of all that stuff. And of course, we don't need to define it. It's defined for us. That's the wonderful thing, is all the definitions are stable. And so we don't feel like we need to. Like in this world, we're constantly making things, trying to define. There, we don't need to make anything. And see, it's interesting that I never had any desire in this world to make anything other than very abstract stuff. Very abstract, that don't have really boundaries or definitions to them. And as far, you know, so in that world, the death-free realm, you don't make anything. You say, what do I do? Do I need to start building homes and inventing toys and making textiles and all the, you know, pharmaceuticals? No, you don't do anything like that. That's not what the training program is about. Training program is one of inner expansion, inner calm, inner peace, inner gratitude. It's an awareness training program. It's even beyond. You can't really define it exactly. It has nothing to do with building roads or building. You won't be building infrastructure. You won't be paving roads. You won't be building dams. You won't be chopping down trees. You won't be manufacturing. You won't be inventing. There's no money there. You will not be investing. Okay. You will not be working to earn a wage. You won't be worried about food. You're inherently nourished there, inherently nourished. You won't be producing families. All right. There's no children there. There's no birthing. There's no families or nothing like that. It's a training exercise. Of those who are going beyond definition. So if you want to keep making, trying to define death, you know, this planet will be here for a little while, and other 3D planets will, or many, 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 you'll find yourself, you know, being born there and continuing cycles of reproduction, reproducing things, definitions. Bodies are just definitions. And of course, in the Holy Spirit's training program, there's none of this nonsense about, oh, the sacred feminine and this of bodies, of things. Oh, how wonderful the mother producing bodies, producing things, producing definitions. There's none of that nonsense there. We're not into worshiping definitions, either male or female. The whole thing, the whole gender thing, that drops away. The whole flesh thing drops away. We're not worshiping form. We're not worshiping definitions. We're accepting the Holy Spirit's definitions as an expedient, a temporary expedient for a training program. But we're not trying to anthropomorphize them, or, you know, in any way. So it's a tremendous, tremendous training for leaving behind the awful, awfulness of this world, of this realm of definitions, that I find so incredibly distasteful. You after a while you can't believe that you ever found anything of this realm palatable whatsoever. Totally non-palatable. It is. I can tell you that from my viewpoint. All this nonsense of the world is totally non-palatable. Indigestible. You just want to spit it out. You just want to spit the whole world out, actually. There's nothing sacred about definition whatsoever. Nothing sacred about it. You can't make it so. You cannot make death sacred. Definitions of death. There is no death. There's only definitions that we define as death. And then efforts to make those sacred and to worship them and to love them and to get familiar with them. All this talk about love in the world is just an attempt to get familiar with these definitions of death, saying, give it a little more time. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. That's all. It means we're not quite, we don't have death yet. There's still definitions, so just give us a little longer. We're just going to try to love it a little more, and we'll just love death into being. With the idea that somehow we can love death and make it real. By loving definitions of death, we can make death real. That's what's taking place here. All this nonsense about love that's been talked about in the world is an attempt to make death real through worshiping it, through being positive towards it, just to embracing it. Say, oh, I love you, definition of death. And this through this love that I have for you, you will become real and I will die, and then I can be resurrected as Prime Creator. That's all nonsense. So all that nonsense is left behind in the real world, in the Holy Spirit's realm. There we understand, there's an intuitive understanding that these definitions are not for the purpose of trying to make death real, but for the purpose of helping us train to go beyond all definitions. There's this intuitive recognition of this. So you trust it. You say, this is not a betrayal. Like, I trust this. I see that everything has been manifested like this specifically. So there's the processes of nature are not present. The processes of birth and death are not present. The processes of decay, growth, decay, are not present. All this stuff. It has a simulation of growth, so we're not freaked out. And it seems very similar. We say, oh, that tree has grown over the years, etc. But it's really manifested instantly, I believe, with the appearance of age as far as growth goes, but no appearance of sickness, disease, a branch falling, a branch withering, you know. Like, I look at this tree here, and you can see there's many, many branches that have fallen off. And underneath the tree, there's all this debris that has fallen down. So there's none of that at all. And so you understand, there's a different purpose to this realm. There's a different purpose. I can feel it. And then, of course, Holy Spirit will explain, you know, what the purpose is. You'll begin to recognize it. So the world right now is frantically saying, no, we have something just as good here. And all this goddess stuff and feminism is saying, hey, we can make this world just as good as the Holy Spirit's realm. If you just put the mother in charge, she will be able to make her children happy. In other words, the children of definition, the children of death, the idea that if we just worship the mother, that the children of death can be happy with their, you know, with their death, as it were. Children of death are definitions. And it simply isn't true. There's no way you can compete with the realm of the Holy Spirit. No way. No way. And this is what gets the world so upset, you know, because they think, no, we should be able to do it. But if we just all get on the same page, we can do it. And that is what's the problem that's coming right now, is the push is to get everyone on the same page, worshiping the mother, as it were. The idea of the mother is that which gives rise to definition. Okay, in this world, we mother nature, meaning the feminine mother, gives rise to definition, meaning things, bodies. And if we just worship the mother instead of the quote-unquote the father, which symbolizes that which is unbounded, not bound by definition, because the father doesn't give rise to things, form. Okay, so that pronoun, masculine pronoun, applying to the prime creator is a useful thing. The prime creator doesn't have any genders, not he, she, male, female, or anything like that. It is completely unbounded, no definition. But in the realm of definitions, it's useful to use the male pronoun for the prime creator. And so in this world, the push right now is to get everybody to worship the mother, okay, that principle, and everybody to be on the same page with that. And if you resist, you're going to be eliminated, period, be lynched. And you can see the lynching is already taking place in emotional, mental, society, cultural ways. People are being lynched right and left. You might say that the planet is the new old South. You know, it's the old South reborn, except they're lynching those who are putting their trust in the Father and the Holy Spirit. They want to lynch Christians is what they want to do, actually. And people of faith around all over the world now are being given a litmus test of faith. Is who are you following, the mother or the father? You know, it's the question type of thing, the archetype. Is it the mother archetype, which gives, in other words, are you following definitions of what you are, which are definitions of death, or are you deciding to drop all definitions of what you are? And that those are the two ways that, you know, they don't touch. They don't really touch at all. You cannot have a compromise between the two because they're both completely inimical to one another. Two different training programs. See, a training program is going in a certain direction. And these training programs of the ego, the training program of the ego, the mother archetype and all that, of trying to define death, that's going in a certain direction. And the Holy Spirit's training program is to drop definitions. It's going in the opposite direction. So you cannot have two directions that are opposite. You cannot put them together, integrate them, can you? You have chaos. If you try to do that, you have this completely chaotic condition. So obviously, you are not being called to integrate the two. The whole thing about integrating these two directions is totally bogus. This is the advice of the ego, of the intellect, of the definition of death. Okay, that's false, wrong advice. So all this stuff again is very wow. You say, wow, this is strong stuff. You will see in the days ahead, you will see why it needs to be this. Because the time is upon us now. The strike is about ready to take place. There is going to be some, you know, attack. You got to understand that the fourth dimensionals, which are those, which is the hierarchy of the attempt to define death as the fourth dimension. that hierarchy is coming to this planet. Okay, the planetary hierarchy of the fourth dimension they've taken over this planet, and they're going to make it a fourth dimensional planet, meaning they're the focus on trying to make definitions real is going to be exclusive. We'll be exclusively focused on this, and all those who are not focused on that are going to be expunged from the planet. That is their plan. And they're in charge now. And the way they function is very subtle. They can function very cleverly and subtly. And so, you know, for them, war is not just people with swords fighting. That's not war on warfare. But they engage in a spiritual warfare. Like St. Paul said, we struggle in this world not in kings and power and potentates of this world, but in principalities and kingdoms in the high realms, in other words, in the fourth dimension. So the struggle here on this planet has been to try to prevent the fourth dimensionals from taking over this planet, which was really what the church, the whole role of the Catholic Church was to, the Christian Catholic Church was to prevent fourth dimensionals from taking over this planet, or at least to delay it. And so they did delay it to this time. But it wasn't, you know, it wasn't a permanent thing. At some point then you have to shift to the Holy Spirit realms. It's just called the ascension or the rapture. So the fourth dimensionals, when they attack in ways that, you know, we may think everything's fine. I don't see any, you know, I don't see riots in the streets, you know, warfare. So their attacks are more subtle than that. And they are attacking ferociously right now, sending a chill throughout the whole planet. You know, lack of forgiveness on this planet is appalling, isn't it? Appalling. People of faith are called to forgive one another. In other words, forgive our definitions. Forgive us our definitions. Understanding that we are struggling mightily with this problem. And when people make mistakes, you forgive them and say, okay, get back on. Like you fall off a bike, you say, pick the kid up and say, get back on your bike, you know. So the real quote-unquote good mothers of this planet are those who are shepherding people into the Holy Spirit realms. Okay, those are the true good mothers. They're not male, they're not female. They're people of faith who are forgiving people, compassionate, forgiving people are the real people of faith on this planet. And those are neither male nor female. That's a Holy Spirit spirit. It's a Holy Spirit spirit. That's wisdom and compassion and forgiveness. So those things, you see that the fourth dimensionals don't have that in them at all. They say, well, thanks for your apology, but we're going to lynch you anyway. That's the fourth dimensionals. They're ruthless because their purpose, of course, is to make death real. Make death real. Okay, so they love not to forgive and to bust heads. So a tremendous strike is coming on this planet. And I do have some information about that, but I have to confirm it, etc. I have my understandings. And we it'll catch us like, wow, what's going on? But we can feel it. We can feel like, hey, like, it just feels like, you know, our sensibilities have been attacked. It's more an attack on sensibilities. It's an attack on orientation. It's attack on our will and our determination and our morale. That's how it's attacked. When they break all those things down, then it's easy then to engage people in what their plan is, to engage people of faith in warfare against each other. Like the whole thing about Islam and Christianity fighting against each other is a trap. Because actually they share very similar faiths. And they're both people of faith. And the fourth dimensionals are trying to get the Christians and Islam to destroy each other in wars. That's what they're trying to do. In other words, the fourth dimensionals don't get their hands dirty. They get the people of faith to make divide and conquer, in other words. So they're trying to instigate these wars, which should not be taking place, but they've been able to emotionalize the situation to the extent that they've been able to do that, and will certainly do more of that. So they're very sneaky, the fourth dimensionals, very, very sneaky. secretive, sneaky, stealthy, you know, devise their own macabre ways of infiltrating. It's the snake in the Garden of Eden. The whole allegory of the snake in the Garden of Eden deals with taking over fourth dimensionals, taking over third dimensional planets. That's what it's all about. The snake is the fourth dimensional, subtle definitions of death and the subtle ways of corrupting the people of faith who are preparing for Holy Spirit worlds, paradise. And they work first through Eve, the feminine principle of saying that, they say, and they're trying to divide the male and the female. And they speak to the feminine pride in producing things and saying, hey, the males are don't really respect you enough. They don't just have you hold you in high enough esteem. But we, the fourth dimensionals, we do. We worship the mother, you see. And the males here, they're worshiping the father. How come they're not worshiping the mother? You know, that's what fourth dimensionals say to the females of a third dimensional planet. And if, you know, females gradually get their minds are like, hey, yeah, I should be more respected more. Because, of course, life on this planet is difficult. We all want more respect. We all want more appreciation, etc. But in our efforts to define death, we suffer anyway. We suffer miserably. And so the wisdom is do not get caught up in this trap that the fourth dimensional set for us, the Adam and Eve trap. But when Eve then gets her head turned to the snake and say, wow, the snake respects me more than my husband does. The snake is telling me I'm the great mother, the great goddess. I should be revered. I should have the finest clothes. I should have the finest jewelry. I should have the finest homes, the finest servants, and the finest cars, and the finest vacations. And everybody should bow and respect me and proclaim me the mother of the universe. That I'm everything good comes from me. And how come my husband's not doing this? And then what happens is there's a propaganda campaign from the fourth dimensional through the media, where every show commercial shows the male as a bumbling fool, unappreciative fool who doesn't know how to appreciate the feminine properly. And the Holy Spirit pointed out to me is you'll watch these commercials, decade 15 years ago or more, and said, what's going on? What's the common denominator? And finally I said, my gosh, about 90% of these commercials portray the male in a very, very, very negative light. And the Holy Spirit says, bingo. And I said, okay, you get it. That's what's happening. And that's just continued on nonstop. So now the male is the bad guy, you know, meaning God the Father is the bad guy, trying to be oriented towards beyond definition is the wicked bad guy. And we're all supposed to worship the feminine principle, the defining principle, principle of definition here. That's the corruption, the Adam and Eve corruption. It tells us what to look out for on this planet. And it's exactly what has happened. So that's why you see men just falling all over themselves, saying, oh, and women, they're the most wonderful thing possible. No, they're not. They have all the problems of definition that men have, and then some. And they need, you know, tremendous support to not get caught up in the pride of definition, like, oh, I'm giving birth to life. No, they're not. They're giving birth to definitions of death. All forms are definitions of death, trying to define what death is. They're not giving birth to life at all. God created spirit. Spirit is life. Spirit is boundless. Spirit is not the flesh. Spirit is not the flesh. So it's very difficult for women to be humble. And men have had to help them, and women help men too. The two are supposed to help each other remain humble and do not take pride in this world, in the things of this world. And the fourth dimensionals come in and corrupt that faith, corrupt it, and they have corrupted it incredibly, corrupted it. So on this planet is entirely corrupt now. The true modesty, what true feminine modesty is to not take pride in the things of this world, okay? And the fact that they give birth to bodies, not take pride in that. Not take pride in their appearance, not take pride in the flesh, not take pride, not worship the goddess, the great mother. That is true humility. That is true Holy Spirit humility. And of course, when women are like that, then it's easier for men to be like that too. Much, much easier. And so that's why men very much appreciate women who have Holy Spirit humility. Very much appreciate, because it helps them greatly. When women get corrupt and they're worshiping the flesh and they have this incredible fake self-esteem and pride and like, oh, we should be worshipped as goddesses, then men end up becoming extremely corrupted too, and they can't seem to resist it. So these are the things that have happened. This planet has been totally corrupted by the fourth dimensionals, as expected, as the Holy Spirit told us would. The church age has now come to an end, as expected, and it's time for graduation now. Many will graduate from this world. But we certainly don't want to stay here much longer, because the corruption will even get to us, or the lynchings will get to us. So at a certain point in time, you know, it's ascension time. It's graduation time. Ascension is just graduation. Is we've learned our lessons, saying, ah, this world is just a training program to try to die, for spirit to try and kill itself. And we see that now. We don't want that. And now we're going to accept the Holy Spirit's training program to drop the attempt to die to what we are, to drop definitions of death. And then that is the graduation. It's a graduation of seeing the options properly. That's the whole thing. The whole thing the Holy Spirit has been trying to do, help us do, during this whole church age, and I don't mean just the Christian church, I mean also Buddhism, Hinduism, Islam, and various other teachings. The whole religious effort has been to help us see the options clearly. What are the two options? What are we choosing between? Because then we can make a meaningful choice. Only when we're able to make a meaningful choice do we graduate. That's it. And that's all we have to do to graduate, is to be able to make a meaningful choice, see the two options clearly. That is it. Because again, all we're graduating into is a different training program. We're not graduating back to reality yet. So we don't have to be perfect. We don't have to have, you know, no. We only have to say, okay, I don't want this one, and I do want this one. I see what this one is about, and I see what this one is going to be about, and I'm choosing this one. I'm choosing the Holy Spirit's training program. That's all we have to do to graduate. And but the fourth dimensional is what they try to tell us. They tried to trick me into saying, you know, if you go to the Holy Spirit's training program, you're going to start out as a neophyte at the very bottom. Whereas if you help fourth dimensionals here worship the mother, which is worship the plan of defining death, you will have a very high position. Very high position. In fact, you will be revered because you will be doing such a great job in helping that you'll be a very high position in this new regime here. The abomination of desolation. And that got me, you know, for a while. Because I hate starting at the bottom all over again. But here's the truth that the Holy Spirit tells us, and Jesus echoed this, is that the lowest in the Holy Spirit's training program is greater than the greatest in the fourth dimensional definition of death program. The very lowest is greater than, way greater than the very greatest in fourth dimensional, third dimensional definition of death training program. Okay? So that means everybody that goes to the Holy Spirit's training program will be higher right off the bat than the very highest in definition of death training program. Think about that. Everyone there is exalted, tremendously exalted, just being there, even before you even start the training program, just being there. It's like going from a high school campus to some Ivy League, some, you know, incredible mega campus, college campus. You walk on the grounds of the college campus and you just say, whoa, I have arrived. You know, it's like, wow. You know, this is something else. This is something else altogether. So when you go to the Holy Spirit's training program, its campus, as it were, paradise, death-free paradise realms, you are more exalted than the very, very highest in the fourth dimensional training program, the training program of death. So it's a bogus argument the fourth dimensionals gave me, you know, saying you can be real high in our program, but you're going to be the lowest in that program. You'll just be a freshman all over again. And I said, I'd rather be a freshman in the Holy Spirit's training program than the dean in the definition of death training program. But that has been a stumbling block. You know, I have to bring it to light and see it, because it seems plausible with what the ego is saying. It seems plausible. The ego is just the marketing program of this definition of death training program. It's just how it markets itself to us and whispers, you know, plausibility to us and keeps us loyal to it. And in the Holy Spirit's training program, again, words fail to, you know, words can't capture it. So you might be thinking, oh, if I go there, maybe Clarity Ross will be there, and he knows so much more, and I won't feel, you know, less than him or something. Not true. Because words completely fail there. And there's an awesomeness there. And everybody feels the same awesomeness. So, and then the training program is beyond anything that's being said here. So I'll just be, you know, I'm just be a freshman with along with everybody else. You know, the valedictorian of a graduating class is still just going to be, you know, freshmen in the Holy Spirit's training curriculum. They're going to start out at ground, you know, just the same as everybody else. They're not going to be like a valedictorian of a high school. They don't go to college and instantly be a valedictorian or anything. No, it's not true. And they don't necessarily progress faster than others too. I don't believe I'll progress faster than others. No, in fact, I'll probably be just kind of somewhere in the middle of the pack is what I feel. I feel that there are many who actually will take to it better than I take to it, actually. That they just have this intuitive sense, they're just able to go with it, you know, and expand their sense of beingness, its definition, expand it easily, more easily than I can, for sure. But again, I'd rather be the least in the Holy Spirit's training program than the greatest in the ego's training program. So that's all you have to accept. See, I'd much rather be the least, because success is guaranteed. Rapid success is guaranteed in the Holy Spirit's training program. You won't fail at all. So you're certain of success. So why does it matter if you start where you start out? If you start out the least, you're still going to quickly succeed. And nobody is doesn't matter who's first or who's last or et cetera, it makes no difference whatsoever. It's the goal, reaching the goal, going beyond definitions. When you're on beyond definitions, there's no definition of success there, who was first or who was last or anything like that. So when Jesus says the first will be last and the last will be first, meaning that those who want to be first in the ego's training program of defining death will be the last ones to enter the kingdom, Holy Spirit's training program. And those who are willing to be least in the ego's training program will be the first ones to enter the Holy Spirit's training program. And like my position in now in the fourth dimensional ego training program for death is super low. I have like no position here, a very lowly position actually. And I look at my future, no position here. It's that low. The only position I have is death here. So I'm super low in this the ego's training program. I've dropped out of its training program. I really have. I dropped out in eighth grade, or seventh, might have been seventh grade. I said, hey, forget it. No. So I plummeted. I've lost all position in this ego's training program to define death. But then that has put me, you know, up towards the head of the line as far as getting to the Holy Spirit's training program. It's interesting. I had a satsang online with Muji, and he said hello to everybody. And I was the very last one he said hello to. The very last one. I said, that's weird. And, you know, I got this feeling. He said, you know what? He says, I need to say hello to these others first because they're very insecure. And if I had greeted them last, they would have freaked out. But he says, you already know. You know what's going on. So I can greet you last, you know, and it won't bother you. And so I said, yeah, that's fine. That's no problem. But that's true, because these others, you know, they're so insecure. I said, Muji, you know, please help me. I don't understand. I'm just so, you know, and so he greets them first. He said, oh, I'm so glad you're here. I love you so much and all this. And I say, thank you, Muji. Oh, God, I'm so, you know. And then he goes to the next and the next and the next. And then here I am waiting through all of that. And then even got my name wrong, you know, and he's saying, it doesn't matter what your name is. You're not hung up on your name. It's just true. I don't care. So he's saying, look, I had to put those others first because they're still struggling with this. But, you know, you got it. You understand. He has no problem. You don't have any problem. So I put you last. I accepted it, you know. I said, yeah, okay. That's fine. At least you got to me. He did it really quickly. I said, yeah, I was like, boom, okay. And on to the next. And, oh, I love all you so much. Yeah. So he's supportive. You know, like someone who's supportive is going to be supporting those who are struggling the most. If there are those who are drowning, let's say there's this river, a strong river, and some of these children are playing in the river, and some venture out in the current, and they're being swept away. And then the quote-unquote, the good mother, father, the one who's responsible, sees that and says, oh my gosh, and goes running out and is grabbing the children who are being swept away in the current. Now, the children who are just sitting on the bank with their feet in the water, who are realize they're very safe and they're smart, and they say, I'm not going to go out in that water because it's dangerous. They don't have to rescue them. They don't have to grab them, you know. And as they're taking these children to safety on the bank, you know, rescuing them, they might smile at the child. They might say, good child, you know, thank you for not bothering me so much. So Muji might just say, thank you, real quick, thank you, but I gotta keep rescuing these people who are in danger of being swept away. So it's like that. It's very great to speak about these things. I'm very happy when I speak about these things. And when I don't, I'm very glum. You know, it's like, God, oh God. We can't speak of these things in the world. It's unbelievable. You know, who can speak of these things now? We're becoming terrified. The fourth dimensionals are terrifying us. They're the real terrorists, the fourth dimensionals. Absolutely. They've been terrifying this planet now. It's the new Inquisition. The new Inquisition has already started. It's going to start next week, probably, actually. You know, the Inquisition, once they get their writ, you know, the papal writ, as it were, it will begin. And test cases will begin. They'll start throwing up all these test cases up. They'll start throwing up more and more severe test cases. Say, okay, target this one. It's designed to intimidate everyone, cow everybody. All these test cases in the media, these high test cases, you know, are designed to intimidate everybody, to crush the morale of people who disagree with what's going on, who disagree with it. Say, wait a minute. This whole program that's going on in the world is to try to worship the flesh, aggrandize the flesh. We don't want that. We don't want that. And that attitude is being demonized now, vilified, demonized, intimidated, threatened, prosecuted. If you get this feeling like you're going to be prosecuted, thrown into jail and lynched, if you say, hey, we do not want to tolerate the attitude of aggrandizing the flesh here. We absolutely do not. We don't want that. Those who are here to aggrandize the flesh, they should be on the lowest rungs of our society. And that is absolutely true. If people want to come here to aggrandize the flesh, to aggrandize this rungs of society here, They should not have a voice at all in culture and society and religion, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. The reason why women have been kept out of high positions in religions is because they have a very severe temptation to start aggrandizing the flesh, their offspring, you know, nepotism. They're feeling, my son or my daughter, they should have high positions too, instead of positions being determined by humility, you know. So there's a severe temptation there, which wise women understand. They say, whoa, no, don't put us in power. Those positions, it's not good for us. It's not good for our salvation. That was just true. It is not. Look what's happened in the world. It's severe, can easily be tempted by those situations. Not that men cannot, they can, but they're less easily tempted. So it's a pragmatic situation. It's not an indiscrimination. It's a situation of pragmatism. So the whole world, the rules and regulations we have are situation of pragmatism. It's not discrimination. It's pragmatism. This is the goal, is to prepare to graduate, and these are the pragmatic positions we need to take. That's all it is. And people of wisdom and reason understand that. It's not discrimination. And yet what's happening is those who want to aggrandize the flesh insist that they've been discriminated against throughout history and been put in low positions through hatred and discrimination, and they need reparations for all of that, and they need vengeance for all that. It's not true. It's simply they were trying to subvert the purpose, our purpose here, which is to graduate from this hellish realm. And so we did not want to give them positions of power and influence over us. Of course not. Of course not. But it's a pragmatic thing. It's not discrimination. It's pragmatism based on what the goal is. So I don't accept guilt at all. I don't accept that at all. It's like when you have a very important job to do, like, and you're doing surgery, you're doing heart surgery, and someone comes in and starts pulling the plug on your equipment and stuff. You say, hey, get them out of here. You know, they're trying to cause the death of this patient. You know, so why should you feel guilty of saying, hey, we don't want you interfering with the surgery here? No, there's no guilt at all. The guilt, if there's any guilt, it should rest on those who are attempting to aggrandize the flesh, attempting to pull us down into continued misery, suffering, and hellish torture. That's where the guilt should rest. So this whole guilt trip that the fourth dimensions are laying on this planet, I reject it entirely. It's a severe guilt trip they're laying on us. And again, the guilt should rest on them, fourth dimensionals, for trying to subvert our right effort towards graduating to the Holy Spirit realms. But that this attitude is under, you know, incredible attack. Incredible attack. This the will to reject this nonsense, this emotionalism, which has no reason behind it whatsoever, complete refusal to accept what they're up to, which is aggrandizing the flesh. Their refusal to acknowledge this at all. There's no dialogue at all. It's only guilt. They're just saying, accept the guilt. And that's all they're saying. And we say, no, we're not accepting the guilt. You have to wear it. You know, because what you're aggrandizing the flesh is an attempt to accomplish the impossible. And only guilt can only rest upon that attempt, because it's really futility. See, guilt is an attempt to refuse to recognize futility. That's actually when guilt arises. When you insist that the impossible can be accomplished, you cover it up. You cover up this feeling of futility by feeling guilty. Saying, I feel so guilty because I'm not working hard enough. I'm not doing what's right. I'm wrong. You know, I should be able to do it. That hides the fact that it's futile. It hides the futility of the effort. So again, the guilt should rest on the fourth dimensionals, the ego's plan. If it rests anywhere, I don't want it to rest anywhere. I want the futility to be recognized. The Holy Spirit wants futility to be recognized. So nobody needs guilt. Just recognize futility. But if you refuse to recognize futility, then the guilt has to rest on that refusal. It will rest on that refusal and not on those who recognize the futility. We absolutely reject guilt because we don't need it. We see what we've been trying to do, which is to accomplish the impossible. We say it's impossible. We accept it. We repent. We accept the Holy Spirit's kingdom as the Holy Spirit's training program, and we ascend into that training program. That's as simple as it can be. We don't need to make any reparations. We don't need to die out of guilt or something like that. Okay? We don't need any of that. We don't accept the guilt, because inevitably the guilt rests on those who are trying to insist that the impossible be accomplished. And so they may insist so strongly that they literally cause their own death, bring about their own persecution and their own deaths. Saying, look, this is what you can do. You can die. I promise you, see. And you can be lowly, and you can be crushed, and you can be this. They say, no. Forget it. Don't want that training program. So what I see, the attack is guilt. Guilt is one of the most vicious attacks possible on those who are trying to graduate, saying, hey, you can't graduate yet. You have to make reparations first. I reject that entirely. Holy Spirit rejects that. Even though, again, people can paint themselves into a corner and then say, hey, you've put me in this corner. No, I did not put anyone in the corner. I've only been teaching truth, been teaching the futility of all this. That's not putting anyone in a corner. Just the opposite. I'm saying the Holy Spirit has an entire realm for you. How is that painting you into a corner? It's impossible. Nonsense. You're painting yourself into a corner and then trying to make me feel guilty for it, you see. And that's saying that your salvation rests upon my death. In other words, me defining what I am, and then, you know, as that which can die, be redefined. So it's a trap. It's the guilt trap. The fourth dimension are using the guilt trap on us. Wow. A lot of commotion out here suddenly. Hell's angels, huh? Wow. Wow, massive motorcycle armada there. Did you hear that? Hey. That's what's coming. Hell's angels. Fourth dimensionals. Barbarians. Did you hear the turmoil there? Good Lord. What they're really saying about guilt is you're guilty for not wanting to aggrandize the flesh. Your refusal is why it doesn't work, and therefore you need to die and be annihilated because you refuse to help us out in our endeavors. That's what they're trying to say when we completely reject that. That it's impossible from the very beginning, and nobody should feel guilty about failing to accomplish the impossible. Period. Period. So we don't need to die for anyone. We don't need to be martyred for anyone, for any reason whatsoever. Wow. I hope the audio captured that. Maybe you can go back and crank up the audio. By the way, I always recommend that people listen to these videos on headphones. Headphones are very cheap now. There's little buds. I saw them at Office Depot for $3. You know, you can get very cheap, and you can hear everything so much better. The background, birds, everything, the atmosphere, so much better than trying to put it on speakers. I always listen to everything on headphones, and it's way, 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 way better. Very cheap, actually, to get headphones. Extreme turmoil is coming in this world. You just heard it right there. I mean, the Holy Spirit must arrange that whole thing, this taping and this thing, and just like, wow. It's like, hey, pay attention. This is the turmoil that's coming. Turmoil is coming. based on a foundation of guilt. They're trying to make people of faith feel guilty, you know. I say no. Now, all attempts to help those who oriented towards aggrandizing the flesh were legitimate attempts to help. There have been many helps trying to say, look, this is the wrong path you're on. Turn around, repent. You're trying to accomplish the impossible, and it can never be accomplished. You need to listen to the Holy Spirit. Many people have tried to give that message out. As Jesus said, you scatter seed everywhere. Some falls on good soil, some falls on stones. Why should we feel guilty about the fact that some seeds fell on stone? You know, fell on those who have extreme spiritual pride. That's not our fault. It's their fault. You know, we shouldn't feel guilty about that. It's not our failure. We tried as best we could. You know, now maybe at some point we'll try better, but our window of doing that is finished now. We have to, the real people of faith, Christian, whatever, follow the Holy Spirit. Follow the grace of God. When the grace of God, Holy Spirit, says, look, it's time to graduate, then you say, okay, you're obedient to the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit says, you've done everything you can do for this phase, this cycle, so now you don't keep trying. Here, it's enough. And you say, well, I want to reach some more. The Holy Spirit says, no. No. Next cycle. Okay, first, complete your training program to go beyond definitions, and then you will be very helpful at the next cycle. So we need to follow the Holy Spirit's advice and say, okay, all right, enough's enough. I didn't reach everybody, a lot of hard hearts, a lot of very spiritually prideful people here in the world, and for this, there's not enough time. The time is not right to begin at their, you know, their process. It's closure time on this cycle now. We knew it was coming. We were warned it's coming. We have a limited amount of time to witness here. So the witnessing time is over now. And the heart, the spiritual prideful ones will do their thing, and they'll be spun off, and they'll find themselves again in some situation where they might finally say, whoa, you know, this is too crazy. I don't want this anymore. And then we'll be able to say, okay, here we go. Listen to the Holy Spirit. I've been through its training program. You can trust it. Become a very powerful witness that time. But how can you be a really powerful witness unless you've gone through the Holy Spirit's training program? How can you? Cannot. You cannot. You have to go through its training program. And then, at that point, you can be very, very potent, powerful witness. It's just that not many have gone through the training program. But the more that do, the greater help all those who are struggling with this guilt and futility and pride and definitions of death and habituated and all these things are, you know, they're struggling so terribly. You will be super helpful to them, super helpful. They'll just say, wow, wow, you know, wow. And they say, well, how did you get like this? And you say, I went through the Holy Spirit's training program. And they say, how can I get in that training program? And he says, okay, I will show you. You have to really apply yourself, you know, and then they'll get really motivated and they will start working at it. But first they have to be motivated, they have to see, you know, that you went through it and you did it. That turmoil really hit me hard, you know, hearing that stuff. That was as nasty as it gets. I've never heard anything quite that bad along the street. It was just on the street right here. It's just like an entire armada of barbarians there, just, you know, roaring and snorting. Just the coffin, just good Lord. Oh, we're not used to that in our peaceful little neighborhood here, my God. But the beautiful birds singing, and it's all so quiet and peaceful. And then suddenly, the pieces just rent asunder by this, you know, vicious sounds of war. Those are like the sounds of war. As I have told you, war is coming here. War is coming to this planet. Sudden strikes. It's all been set up. It's all been set up. The higher-ups know about it. there may be preemptive stuff. I mean, the strike, sudden strikes. There is an entire war game scenario that's been set up, actually, is what I've been shown. I wasn't given specifics. They say, we can't give you any more than this, is what they told me. He said, we have oaths of secrecy, but we are able to give you certain parameters and tip you off. Yeah, yeah, this definitely is coming. And so look out. Wow, that really, I was really severely startled there. As we will be when it strikes, when this all goes down. We'll be shocked. We'll be shocked next week by what happens next week. This last week, and then this next week, the last week of June, as it were, are going to be very shocking, for sure. I believe, you know, I hope the ascension process begins July 1st, or June 30th, July 1st. And it could be that the strike on this planet begins also at that time, around June 30th or sometime. So we're in the time frame. And again, it could be subtle. It could be subtle. It could be, you know, the technology that they have now. It's subtle technology, waveforms, all sorts of, you know, electronic warfare and things like that. But it impulses people into battle. They're trying to impulse the Christians and the Islamic nations into war. They're trying to get the world into a world war by mental impulsing, mentally using waveforms, etc., satellites and things like that, to start an all-out war here. World War III. But again, we don't have to witness that. It has nothing to do with our new training. So why even pay attention to it? It's irrelevant. For us, it's irrelevant. We've already seen through the situation. Already seen through it. And of course, the program to define death. It's trying to graduate too, right now. And so it wants to bring its graduation commit, and its graduation exercises is World War III and all these catastrophes that are coming upon the planet. Release of biochemical agents around the globe and all this stuff. That's its commencement exercises. Dude, that's its big party commencement exercise, saying, look how well we've been able to define death. How does it do that? By showing annihilation of everything on the planet, actually. We were told that the final catastrophes come on the planet, everything on the planet will be annihilated if those days weren't cut short, you know. So that's its commencement exercises. So it's about to hold their commencement. The 4D, 3D plan, ego's plan to define death, is about ready to have their graduation, their commencement exercises. So the Holy Spirit's also ready to have its graduation. They'll both happen in a very close time frame, actually. Probably first the ego's commencement may start first. I don't know for sure, but usually that's the way it goes, just so it's not feeling like it's our decisions being forced upon us or something. We'll see. But in close proximity, I would say. In close proximity. Now, everybody knows that these words are true, but they say, yeah, but I don't know if I'm quite ready for it. Of course, who's ready for it? You know, who is ready for it? The thing is, though, we just need to be ready enough for it. You know, don't get caught in this idea we got to be perfectly ready for it. No, you know, just like that shook me up, those that motorcycle gang, that, you know, it's like, whoa, it shook me up. But I'll recover from it, you know. He said, it passed by. You see, I didn't see it. It passed by, like in a distance. So for sure, I feel like, yuck. But one reaction that came up, very tiny reaction, like, let me grab this camera and go out there and see what's going on, tape it. And just instantly said, no, you know, just like, gone. almost with no effort. So that shout, you will bypass it. You won't see it at a distance. You'll feel the turmoil from a distance, just like we heard that motorcycle gang at a distance. And you'll say, I don't want to, you know, go running and find out what's there, get into it and see what's going on, experience it. No, forget it. I don't need to. I don't want to. Yeah, sure, when a band of pirates go sailing by, you might want to say, look at all those crazy, zany people with all the tattoos and piercings and weird hairstyles and weird clothes and weird attitudes and twisted expressions and hostility and anger and fights and everything. You say, that's kind of like weird, I want, you know, like a carnival, I want to see what that is. And you might have a little bit of temptation there, but you just say, no, forget it, let it pass. So it'll be like that. You'll have a little tug, but easily just no. I'm way too much into the sublime right now. Way too much into the sublime. So do not aggrandize the mother. Turn to the sublime. Okay. Do not aggrandize the flesh through using the symbol of the mother. Go towards the sublime, which is beyond the flesh entirely. We will see what I can do. I don't know. It's a tricky thing right now. But this is enough for now. Incredibly profound taping here. Yeah, it's just like it's rocked me. And amazing. It is on. And we are going to graduate, period. We are going to graduate. That's it.